Hello, wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be talking about some really intriguing discoveries in regards to the origin of the core of Mercury. The discovery which potentially may help us understand why certain planets have certain types of cores, and can also help us understand how we can potentially use this technique in identifying and analyzing various planets outside of the solar system, the so-called exoplanets. And although this discovery is to some extent somewhat unusual and somewhat unexpected, it's important to understand what the problem here was to begin with. And I guess the problem starts right here, with the four terrestrial planets in the solar system. Now, the smallest one here is Mercury, and the largest one here is Earth. But if we try to open up these planets and try to analyze their insides, specifically looking at things like the inner core, and compare the sizes of cores to the sizes of these planets, we would discover a slightly different pattern. Even though Mars is the second smallest object, it has the smallest iron core of all four planets, with Mercury being second, Venus being third, and Earth having the largest iron core. But then if we look at the proportions of the iron core to the mass of the planet, suddenly here Mercury comes on top. Mercury has the largest iron core of all of them, with Earth being second, Venus being third, Mars being fourth. Now, this is not the mystery, this is actually something that we've known for a very long time, but the original explanation, well, it was not really satisfactory. Originally, the explanation suggests that Earth and Venus are just sister planets, so they have a relatively similar size core. Mars is a little bit farther on the outskirts, so it didn't really get enough metal, whereas Mercury was probably much, much more massive and much larger in the beginning. But because of a lot of different collisions in the beginning of the solar system, it was very likely stripped of the outer layer, losing a tremendous amount of matter and a lot of different rocks and silicates in the process. And so the explanation here was that maybe the outer shell of Mercury just kind of disappeared because of the early collisions. And to date, this is the most accepted explanation in regards to the formation of this really large core. The core here is so large, as a matter of fact, that Mercury is the only other terrestrial planet that has an active magnetosphere, although not as powerful as planet Earth. Neither Venus nor Mars have magnetospheres. But this explanation was not accepted by all scientists and didn't really explain everything about Mercury's origins. And because of this, the scientist, whose paper you can find in the description below, and whose main author is also known for developing an interesting Earth model that is often used to determine composition of different exoplanets, presents an entirely different model and a very satisfactory explanation for the differences between these terrestrial planets. The new model here relies on the idea behind the early planetary formation in the beginning of the solar system, when the solar system was just a protoplanetary disk. During these early times in the solar system, the Sun was very different. This was a protoplanetary disk, and it was very likely just a large amount of dust, a large amount of different types of grains of iron and a lot of other materials, and a lot of magnetic fields. Today we know that a lot of these protoplanetary disks are extremely magnetically active. The interaction between the star and the magnetic field is actually responsible for the majority of these stars' initial growth. A lot of these early stars grow by absorbing a tremendous amount of material that falls along these magnetic lines that you see right here. And because of these early interactions and tremendously powerful magnetic fields, combined with the fact that magnetic fields usually become weaker as you move away from the object itself, results in the formation of a kind of a gradient along the length of the protoplanetary disk. The more magnetic field we find here, the more metallic materials we're going to discover as well. And as you move away from the disk, you're going to find less and less metallic materials. And depending on the location where the early planets were developed, they would have a different proportions of different materials present. The closer to the Sun they were, the more likely they would have a lot more iron present on the inside. And based on the model, there should be a kind of a correlation between the distance where the planet developed and the amount of, or the proportions of, metal present inside the planet, which at the same time also should correlate with the average density of the planet as well. Well, it just so happens, if we try to graph this and if we actually put this into some sort of a table, we'll get something that looks like this. The part on the left shows us the average density, whereas the axis on the bottom shows us the distance from the Sun. And it looks like there's a very high correlation between the distance from the Sun, the planetary density, and also the size of the iron core on the inside compared to the rest of the planet, which also correlates with the total strength of the magnetosphere of the early solar system. And this is a really important finding because it essentially allows us to understand that the magnetosphere or the magnetic effects from these early solar systems or early star systems is extremely important in helping us understand what the actual exoplanets or other planets are going to be made out of. Their composition depends on the magnetosphere. And because the scientists in this paper also calculate how the magnetic field would most likely draw a lot of these metallic materials, while also controlling the presence of other types of elements in the planetary disk, it also helps us understand what other elements we might be able to discover in certain star systems or even in the planets in our own solar system. So in other words, we can actually use the calculations from various magnetic field studies to try to figure out where exactly we're going to find certain elements and possibly then apply this to some other planet somewhere out there. At the same time, this sort of gives us a way to look for planets with potential life on the surface. So for example, today we know that inside our own planet, a lot of the essential for life elements such as phosphorus are actually stuck inside the core. This was something that happened because of the distribution of different elements and of course the interaction with the magnetic field when the solar system was still very young. This also of course means that we might be able to use these techniques to find other planets out there that have very similar composition and very similar life-giving elements on the surface as well. Although naturally that's not something we're able to do just yet. At the same time, this now helps scientists to be a little bit more careful when analyzing exoplanets as well. For example, let's just say we found a star system such as this one, TRAPPIST-1, where we know what the star is made out of. We understand the composition of the star pretty well. But does that mean that we can kind of figure out what the planetary composition is just based on the star itself? Well, this particular study implies that the answer is no, we cannot really know the composition of a planet that way. As a matter of fact, it implies that we need to understand how the star transformed and more importantly, what sort of a magnetic field it had in the beginning for us to try to determine what the planet is going to be like. So if we actually discover that TRAPPIST-1 used to be an extremely highly magnetic star system, it does give a lot of these planets a really high chance of being very similar to planet Earth. They might have very high iron content and possibly even have really strong magnetospheres. But unfortunately, just looking at the star and the elements present in the star is not really going to provide any of these answers. And the major problem here is that we do not really have a very good way of determining the magnetic field of a typical star by just looking at it with our telescopes from planet Earth. There are no current techniques known to us that can actually establish if these particular stars used to be extremely magnetic and possibly provided a lot of iron for various planets, or they were more or less quiet and did not get a chance to create a kind of a gradient we observe in the solar system, which could be true of some of these smaller stars such as red dwarfs or maybe some other stars, because we're not entirely sure if the star formation for some of these stars is different from one another. But I guess the new question is, well, can we actually prove any of this? Is it an actual theory, or is this just a coincidence that seems to work for the solar system? Well, to try to answer this, the scientists now would have to find another star system, hopefully very, very similar to the solar system, where they can actually see a lot of different rocky planets kind of similar to what we have here around the Sun. And if in that particular star system they're able to measure the density of planets, and discover that there seems to be a very similar density gradient present in that particular star system as well, well, in that case, it does become an actual theory, and the scientists might have discovered something we never knew before, which would of course then raise a lot of other questions. Can we somehow use this to predict structures of various planets, depending on the properties of a typical star? So definitely a lot of things to consider here. The other thing that is actually kind of interesting, and that's to me personally, is in regards to the formation of planets in our own solar system based on the graph that I showed you previously. And specifically in regards to Venus. Now in the paper they do refer to Venus as Earth analog, but technically, according to their theory, Venus should be somewhere higher up here. And so does this imply that either Earth was actually created closer to the Sun, or that Venus was created further away? Or maybe even both? And so maybe this is something that some of the future studies can actually answer as well. It could be obviously just a coincidence, or maybe just an exception, or maybe the graph itself is not super accurate, but it's still something that I would love to know the answer to. Either way, well, that's pretty much all I want to mention in this video. Check out the paper and all of the relevant links in the description below. Subscribe if you still haven't, share this with someone who loves learning about space and sciences, and maybe come back tomorrow to learn something else. Maybe support this channel on Patreon by joining the channel membership or by buying the wonderful person t-shirt you can find in the description. Either way, stay wonderful, I'll see you tomorrow, and as always, bye-bye.